Hello students, welcome to this video. In this video we are going to learn grade 8 English Honeydew book lesson 3, third, glimpses of the past. Glimpses of the past is the lesson that we are going to discuss in this video. Glimpses, a view, a short view of the past. Some of the incidents which took place some long years before has been taken as picture now through this lesson to make you understand something about our history. Okay, glimpses of the past, some past incidents, some short view of the past. Okay, before you read, here are some pictorial glimpses of the history of our country from 1757 to 1857. So the things whichever took place in the years between 1757 to 1857, these 100 years, some of the specific incidents has been taken through this lesson to get you understand about the history. These pictures and speech bubbles, yes, pictures as well as speech bubbles will help clarify your understanding of the conditions. Okay, understanding of the conditions that led to the event known as the First War of Independence in 1857. So the First War of Independence, which took place in the year 1857. So some of the incident that those were leading to happened, this incident of the First War of Independence in 1857. Okay, so here are some pictorial glimpses. Let us discuss about one by one. Okay, the first one, the Martyrs. The Martyrs, what are those Martyrs? The people, those who lost their lives for their country, for their country, are called as the Martyrs. Here the first pictures gives you some information. This is Lata Mangeshkar and Jawaharlal Nehru, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Lal Bahadur Shastri and Indira Gandhi. See, at a function in Delhi, some function which took place in Delhi, was singing a song for the Martyrs. Okay, oh my countrymen, let your eyes fill with the tears as you recall the sacrifice of India's Martyrs. So this is from Lata Mangeshkar. Oh my countrymen, let your eyes fill with the tears as you recall the sacrifice of India's Martyrs. So some of the freedom fighters, Bhagat Singh, Netaji, Jawaharlal Nehru, and Mahatma. So some freedom fighters pictures have been added here. Second one, the Company's Conquest. The Company's Conquest, East Indian Company's Conquest, 1857 to 1849. With its superior weapons, the British East India Company was extending its power in 18th century India. If you look at the history of India in 18th century, India was dominantly controlled by Indian princess once. Okay, Indian princess. See, this is the picture which tells us which what happened in 1765. In the year 1765, many parts of India was controlled by Indian princess. Okay, the color which is in pink was taken. The whole control was taken by British. Okay, so the pink color areas are controlled by British. So this place, these places are called British territory. Are the remaining part yellow? The whole part, majority of the part of India has been controlled by Indian princess. Indian princess. This is what the situation which took place in the year 1765. With its superior weapons, how the East Indian Company were able to control the Indian princes because of their modern weapons. The weapons which they used were so strong when it is compared to the Indian princes, Indian weapons. Okay, so it was quite easy for them, for East India Company, to subdue the Indian princes. Okay, it was very difficult to conquer to the Indian princes because of the strength of the superior weapons. Okay, so with its superior weapons, by using their superior weapons, the British East India Company was extending its power. Okay, they are slowly increasing their power from this area to other part of the India, which happened in 18th century. Indian princes were short-sighted. Okay, Indian princes were short-sighted. We know short-sighted means they are not thinking about the future, but at the point of time they wanted to settle down their own issues. So Indian princes were called short-sighted. Short-sighted. That upstart Rajaba called the English merchants, they will help me to defeat him. So why these Indian princes were called as short-sighted? Because if any misunderstanding happened between the Indian princes, one prince sought help from the British to subdue the other, to defeat the other king. So this incident, these kind of incidents helped British to subdue the whole India, other kings. So that is why Indian princes were called the short-sighted. Okay, upstart, the upstart Raja Bhav. Okay, the upstart Raja Bhav called the English merchants. So you call the English merchants, they will help us to defeat him. So now here the Indian king, one of the Indian prince, he wanted to get help from British to control his rivalry. Okay, his control is enemy of one Indian prince. The people had no peace due to such constant fights. So because of their constant fighting between the kings, people had no peace due to such constant fights. See, the rivalries helped the East India Company and it could easily subdue Indian princes one by one. So the East India Company, for them it was so easy to control, to subdue the Indian princes. How? Because one helped the British India Company just because of he wanted to control his own Indian enemy. So that's why they sought help from the British. So it was quite easy to control other kings by the East India Company. The rivalries helped the East India Company and it could easily subdue Indian princes one by one. So one by one, they slowly, they were able to subdue the Indian princes. A far-seeing ruler like the brave Tipu of Mysore fought the British till he died fighting. See, already we discussed Indian princes were short-sighted, Indian kings were short-sighted, because one sought help from the British in British people to defeat other Indian prince. But some kings, some people were far-seeing ruler, okay, just opposite of what we discussed in the previous part. A far-seeing ruler like the brave Tipu of Mysore fought the British till he died in fighting. Okay, the Tipu Sultan, we knew him well. We must have studied in history part. A far-seeing ruler like the brave Tipu of Mysore. He was so very far-seeing person, far-seeing ruler like the brave Tipu of Mysore fought the British till he died fighting. But Tipu Sultan was not like other kings. So how did Indians react to this conquest? Okay, so we talked about short-sighted people and far-seeing Tipu Sultan. So different kind of situation, different kind of people, different kind of princes were in India at that point of time. So how did Indians react to this conquest? Okay, so one prince sought help from British to defeat other king, and one more side, on other side, some people will fight, some princes like Tipu Sultan were ready to fight against the British. How did Indians react to this conquest? That is what we are going to discuss now. How did Indians react to these conquests? Thank God, there is peace in the country now. No more wars and no looting by thugs. Okay, so people were very upset, very fed up because of the constant fighting. Now, because of the East Indian Company, they started to feel something new. They thanked the God. Thank God, there is a peace in the country. There was a belief that hereafter no war would happen. Okay, so they thank God there is peace in the country now. No more wars and no looting by thugs. It is God who sent the British. So British were sent by the God. It was the belief in the Indians. There was a belief in Indians. It is God who sent the British. Our destiny is linked with them. So we already fed up because of the constant fighting. Now the British people has arrived here. So our destiny is linked with them. Okay. It is God who sent the British. Our destiny is linked with them. This is the one view of the Indians. Let us see the other view of the Indians. The white man has killed or dethroned our kings. Now just opposite of what we studied in the previous picture. See, the white man has killed or dethroned our kings. So these people, now some people of Indians, of India, thought differently. They don't like the British people took the control of Indians. The white man has killed or dethroned our kings. They removed the power. The white people has come here and removing the power of Indians power of the princes. Some kings were not good. Yes, of course we agree, some kings were not good, but after all they were of this land. Okay, even though they are not good, still they are from our own country. Okay, now we have become slaves of foreigners. Okay, now we have become slaves of the East Indian Company, the British people, the foreigners. Now we have become slaves of foreigners. So now we are going to move on to the third part, British rule. Okay, British rule, 1765 to 1836. Religious leaders preached ideas like untouchability under child marriage. Okay, preached means giving lecture. Okay, giving lecture suggestions, you can say like that. Okay, religious leaders like the people, those who are good in giving speeches, religious leaders preached ideas like untouchability and child marriage. See, the one man says something, speech bubbles. This is what the speech bubble. He says something. What is that? Anyone who crosses the seas loses his religion. If somebody who goes beyond this land will lose their religion, okay, such kind of thinking. See in this picture, all the misery in the world is due to woman. So this is superstitions. Okay, all the misery means bad things, sad things. Okay, all the misery, the problems which they are experiencing existing time, the point of time, the problems whichever making them to get worried. Okay, all the misery in the world is due to woman. Because of the woman, they believed, the people believed that because of the woman, the all the things which has been taken place. The truth was that Indians had lost self-respect. The British scorned them. Okay, the truth was that Indians had lost self-respect. Yes, of course, Indians lost self-respect. But the British scorned them. Scorn means hated them. Okay, the British hated them. Here is the speech bubble. The native are unworthy of trust, incapable of honesty. One British man says something to his superior. The natives are unworthy. The natives here refer to the Indian own land people. Okay, the natives are unworthy of trust, incapable of honesty. True, your honor, but I am honest. Okay, true, your honor, but I am honest, says some of the Indian prince. Being merchants, the British wanted quick profits. Of course, they are not here to control the people, but they came here to make business. Doing business is their prime motto. Being merchants, okay, businessmen. The British wanted quick profits. Their heavy taxes forced farmers to abandon their fields. So they leveled too much taxes, on the farmers. So what the farmers did was they were giving up doing agricultural activities, doing farming works, because of the taxes that was leveled against them. But your men taking all, here is the speech bubble, one Indian farmer, says to the British, "But your men are taking all my crop." So what is the answer he got from the British? "You are still in arrears," which means still you are in debt. "If you don't pay next week, I will send you to jail." So this is what the message given by the British. Inevitably, famine means lack of food. Okay, it was the time people were suffering because of their not having food, enough food. Inevitably, famines followed between 1822 and 1836. 15 lakh Indians died of starvation without food because of their hungry. 15 lakh Indians died of starvation because without food they died. 15 lakh Indians died. The goods manufactured in England should not have any import duty when brought into India. Okay, if goods manufactured in British in England, it was imported to India. Okay, it was brought into India, but no taxes. Okay, a good idea. The discussion was going on between them. The East India Company's laws began to cripple Indian industries. Cripple means deterioration. Okay, they are stopping the growth of Indian industries. Okay, the East India Company's laws began to cripple Indian industries. The British policies ruined the expert artisans and their business. Okay, the policies which were made by British was not favorable to the Indians, especially expert artisans and their business. Now we are moving on to the fourth part, Ram Mohan Roy, 1772 to 1833. Ram Mohan Roy, a learned man from Bengal, understood what was wrong with the country. Ram Mohan Roy, a learned man from Bengal, understood what was wrong with the country. Ram Mohan Roy is one person from Bengal, and he was a learned person. Okay, he learned many things. He was educated, so wise, very much intelligent. Okay, let us not despise ourselves. Let us not cheat ourselves. Our ancient culture is great. Okay, let us not despise ourselves. Okay, which means we are degrading ourselves, cheating ourselves. Okay, despise ourselves. Our ancient culture is great, and we are capable of greater achievements. We must first reform our society. Superstitions have been ruining us, because already we discussed in the previous part, superstitions. What was those superstitions? Some people believed in India all the miseries because of the woman. Okay, and also if you go beyond, if you cross the sea, you will not be considered in this religion. Okay, they are doing wrong against the religion. That was those are the superstitions were very much prevailed in India those days. So here Ram Mohan Roy is such an intelligent person, is a wise man, a learned man, has come out and say something about the superstitions. Let us not despise ourselves. Our ancient culture is great, and we are capable of greater achievements. We must first reform our society. Superstitions have been ruining us. Because of the superstition, our society has been spoiled. Okay. he told his wife Uma, okay, Raja Ramamohan Rai's wife Uma, he told his wife what, see, cows are of different colors, but the colors of their milk is the same. Okay, cows, we have cows in many colors, but still the milk which we produce from them is remaining in one color, which is white. Different teachers have different opinions, but the essence of every religion is the same. So different teachers teach different things, but the essence is same. He was attracted by science and modern knowledge. Who? Raja Ramamohan Rai was attracted by science and modern knowledge. He did not believe the superstitions, but he had faith in science and the knowledge. Knowledge should be practical and scientific. Okay? Knowledge should be practical and scientific. He crossed the seas. See, he broke the superstition here. Raja Ramamohan Rai crossed the seas. If someone crossed the sea, is not being considered as the own religion. But here he crosses the seas and went to England to see what made the British powerful. That he told them. See, he crossed the seas and went to England to see what made the British powerful. That he told the British people, told them means the British. He refers to Raja Ramamohan Rai. We accept you as rulers. Okay, you have been ruler of Indian part. Okay, we accept you. Okay, we are ready to accept you, and you must accept us as subjects. Okay, you don't treat us as slaves. Okay, you must accept us subjects, but you must remember the responsibility a ruler owes to his subjects. Okay, we are ready to accept you as a ruler. You must ready to accept as subjects, and also you must understand the responsibility of the ruler owes to his subjects. Subjects means people of the country, people of their land. People of the land. He started newspaper. Who? Raja Ramamohan Rai started newspapers, but the suspicious British stopped them in 1825. Doubtful. Suspicious means doubtful. Who is doing something against the British? So that's what the thinking of the British. So they stopped the newspaper. He started newspapers, but the suspicious British stopped them.